Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I want to have the opportunity. Mr. Speaker, let me begin by talking about the economic problem in this country. Mr. Speaker, the economic problem of this country emanates from a liquidity problem. And I want to further explain so that Mr. Speaker said this House can appreciate what I'm talking about. Liquidity is like blood in somebody's body. And when your body hasn't got enough blood, you become anemic. And when you become anemic, it affects the lungs, it affects the liver. It affects many organs of the body because there's no blood. So the problem is liquidity. There is no cash in the country. There's no money in the country. Second, Mr. Speaker said, Zimbabwe is a country which is so rich but has no cash. And let me explain this. You have Mr. White, who has got shares on the stock exchange, which are worth $20 billion. They're in his check, they're in his pocket. And then you have got Mr. Brown, who has $10 cash. And you have a scenario where they both want to jump onto a taxi. And the taxi driver requires $5. Mr. White has got $20 billion worth of checks in his pocket. Mr. Brown has got $10 cash. Who will get that taxi? Is it Mr. White with $20 billion checks in his pocket, or is Mr. Brown with $10 in his pocket? It's Mr. Brown with $10 in his pocket cash because the taxi is $5. I want to further qualify this by saying we talk about a deficit, but then with that deficit you also talk about a surplus. Before you even factor in that deficit, how can you talk about a surplus? You are owed. You owe the money, the bank money, you're overdrawn. And then you've got you owe the bank 50 million. You're overdrawn. And then you don't take the money to the bank, but you keep telling people I've got 20 million. You owe 50 million, which is overdrawn. And you've got 20 million, Mr. Speaker said, which you have not taken to the bank, because you know when you go to the bank, it will be taxed. But then say we have a surplus because of the 20 million. That's basically what this surplus is about, without considering the money that is owed. We are constantly sugarcoating the deficit. And because of that, the minister, with due respect, had been given an opportunity to take cognizance of his predecessors who had problems. And say clearly to the country, Mr. Speaker said, that as a country, I'm taking this office on a background of so many things, which were not as a result of my doing. But I will correct these things first before we move forward. We talk about the IMF. When Dr. Bono was in office, he still dealt with the IMF, he held the money, nothing happened. Honorable Beatty mentioned the IMF issue, that we are constantly being played around it. IMF said no reforms, cut down the workers, cut down everything. We are on a mission to do that. There is no money that comes in. Their delegations are coming into Zimbabwe all the time. When they finish their work, they go to Victoria Falls. And then they go. I mean, how can you have one organization giving you the same conditions, but yet they don't take into consideration the IMF money which was paid before? New money must be paid. Mr. Speaker, for as long as we are constantly voting for the budget in this house, where first of all it's 1 to 1, and we all know the budget that we passed was in US dollars, and then suddenly we then have a surplus. Let me move to vote number 2, which is the welfare of Salvadorians. I want to talk about what I know best. We passed a budget. Mr. Speaker said, only 17% of what we passed has been given back. 17%.
And this is July, August.
So, he needs more money. 17%, this is Parliament, which is supposed to be one of the 3 arms of the state, which is responsible for legislation, responsible for oversight and representation. And these issues must be dealt with. We must be seen to be working hard. We have been accused of many things by so many people because of lack of understanding of our remuneration. I think that it is about time that the people of Zimbabwe knew how much a member of parliament is paid. His or her medical aid. The coupon that they have, is there money, is there fuel or not fuel? We talk about staying in these hotels. This government is the most hypocritical government where it allows us to stay in hotels, but it's not prepared to give us the money to stay in hotels to find someone to stay.
Amen, yes.
If we talk about austerity measures, we must move out of those hotels and be given an allowance a month of $3,000 for accommodation and food. These members will be having mortgages, they'll be having houses as a result of that. But this government is spending so much money staying in hotels. None of these members want to stay in hotels.
No!
If you calculate the amount of money we spend in hotels, a day is $200. The Mikos is in US dollars. He's paying in US dollars. He's prepared to pay the Mikos in US dollars and other. No, I'm not saying the Mikos is bad. It's their line of doing business. You now have a situation where $200 per week, that's $1,000. The next week, that's $1,000. So in a month, that's $4,000. You can rent a 1-bedroom apartment for $500 and 500 food, and the rest goes into other issues. We have never been offered that members of parliament. We have a situation where those who are staying in hotels are spending 1,200 per day. Those who are not staying in hotels are getting $60 Zimbabwe dollars, which is equivalent to $6. So what I'm urging members of parliament to do is to all stay in hotels even if you stay in a house. Because you'll be getting $6 per day. What is the point? He's talking about austerity measures. And we're offering him that. That here, if you want to stay in a hotel, give us at least 3,000 per month. Less 1,000. We are helping him. We are not a parliament which is selfish. We are the first parliament to offer the government an avenue for austerity measure by saying, the 4,000 that you spend a month on us, give us 3,000. Honourable members, are you not prepared for that?
Yeah.
So here we have people saying to us, the government expenditure has not decreased. The ministers are still driving the VX that he's so bent on us not having. They are having in a second basis. They are still traveling around the world. What is the point of those ambassadors in those countries? What is the role of the Minister of Foreign Affairs? The office of the ambassador of an embassy has got an economic affairs person whose job is to lobby on behalf of the government any business. So they are there to do that. The Minister of Foreign Affairs or the Minister at that time, paperwork is done, all they do is sign and they go back. Minister of Foreign Affairs is there to move around to the President to do what they have to do and so forth. But we have these embassies which are not working. Let's talk about this blue book budget here. We go to the members of parliament. No, we cannot continue to be treated like kids and to have issues which are... you are denied this blue book because they think you're going to see what he's talking about. We want to discuss this blue book before us, not any other blue book. For him to tell us, no, I've got the 20% in the other blue book. We don't know if we're discussing this one.
Yeah.
This is a review. The other blue book has no review. Because I know what he was saying with the issues that are raised. And the officials are here. who you say that I representing? In that, don't take us back to the old group. It's nothing. We want to talk about this one that you invited. You are the ones who came up with the interbank rate as means of finance. But you apply it as and when you think you should. You collect duty on interbank, but you pay people at your own rate that you want. How can you be a government that cheats so open? The interbank, who brought the interbank? Who brought the interbank? It's not going on the fire. It is the bank government that bank brought the interbank. The only thing I'm asking, which is fair and square, is may everything be prorated to the interbank. That's it. It's up to them where they get the money. We had one-to-one, and people's money is stolen. RTGS, Mr. Speaker said, members of parliament, were we not with the RTGS two years ago? So how come this one is so different from that one? How is this one so different from the other one? Maybe I'm mistaken, but 6 months ago we had an RTGS multi-currency, it was part of it. So why is it so different from this one? Because they play games with people's account, in the old Nostro account, they want to raise foreign currency, immediately they now come up with a different thing. He talked about like to like, he said that, like to like. Like to like, in what else? When there's so much inconsistency in the money policies, there is no one who will ever put in this money for as long as there's inconsistency in the money policies. No one. Because I'll tell you, how can I put in US dollars? I don't know what else you do. They're even scared to put money in bonds. Because they don't know what the next currency will be. We are the only country that has destroyed every currency. We are only left with the pound. Which currency have we not saved in this country? With the reason of going to market currency was to give us a leeway to recover. Where resources are being mined, there's production. There's no production happening, there's no resources. There's just been the Minister of Mines, I don't know when he was last here. He talked that his ministry is critical, honorable, in terms of the GDP. It is the quickest way to make money. These are the lower hanging fruits. The deals that have been signed by the Minister of Mines amounts to how much? 2.4 billion, 3.4 billion, and so forth. But this country cannot even pay 10 million Zesa. But we boast about having investors who have signed $1 billion. I mean, where are we going? Are we stupid? We cannot even get $10 million to pay for electricity. You go to the to vote number two on the constituency development plan. It's reduced to 21. At interbank, just that the officials cannot answer, they've said what is related to interbank. So that they tell us. You introduced interbank sitting right there. You are the technocrats who have been lying to the minister too. Okay? And he comes here. What is it that you're advising the minister? What are these technocrats in the ministry advising the minister? We have technocrats who don't know what they're doing, Mr. Speaker. Who are constantly, all their goodness, advising the minister and traveling the minister and getting around. We need to have a situation where the interbank is effective. Talking about the constituency development plan, it was $50,000. That's for a tent for 5 years. Mr. Speaker said, for 5 years, it's 50,000. That 50,000, if you multiply this, it's now 11,000.
I'm sorry.
I am a professional. And at no point did I address them. I'm talking about technocrats.
Yes.
I'm talking about technocrats. At no point, unless I'm not allowed to use the word technocrats, then I withdraw. They are technocrats who advise ministers. And so you know their names. I'm just looking at them, but you're following my eyes and not listening to what I say. You see? It's now gone down. Mr. Speaker, it has now gone down to 11,000. And all we are saying here on the blue book, can this figure be met with interview rate? That's all. We are asking the minister to deal with the currency that he has, not that he has a vote. And it's up to us and the suppliers to see what they'll do with the interbank money. That's not his problem. Let him give us an interbank. Because we're buying everything at interbank. So we must equally be given that at interbank. You've got the cards, which I talked about, if you go. 81 million. 81 million with this immense. At 9 is 25,000. Yeah. Stories have been mentioned. We started at 80, we passed the budget at 80. Because we are stupid, because others are weak, because and so forth, they take advantage of that and say, no, it's down. They have a tendency of using the name of the president. The president, if he wants anything to be changed in parliament, he deals with the speaker. Let ministers not use the name of the president where they want to advance the agenda. Some of us are allowed to go and see the president and ask him. Because anybody has access to them to verify. He understands and respects this institution. He's never interfered in this institution. But you have people saying, no, we have been told this by the president, we have been told this by the president. The president, the constitution is very clear. If the president wants to communicate to parliament, he will reduce it in black and white. He will equally tell the speaker. The members of ZANU-PF, of which you are at the caucus, you heard what the president said about the caucus. While you might not have been happy, but say once parliament decides, it decides. But then we hear the president say this and that, this and that, this and that. We want to stick to what we agreed in this time. That's all we want. The cars must go. This 80 million must go at interbank. Let's give these car companies money at interbank. It's up to them to look for the foreign currency. This is all we are demanding at the end of the day. This is not only for us, but I talk about every Zimbabwean civil servant that their money must go to interbank. You talk about a cushioning allowance. What is a cushioning allowance? What is a cushioning allowance after 7 months of not being paid and giving a cushioning allowance for a week? We want their salaries to go by the interbank. That's all we're asking for. Nothing less, nothing more. Fair play, because they introduced the interbank and said, this is the currency of the day. No head was put to the Minister of Finance to say that may you choose the RSTGS. He brought it up himself. Austerity measures, what are austerity measures? Zimbabwe is meaning austerity measures that you must suffer. A good doctor is the one that heals a patient using the ICD. I'll repeat, a good doctor is one that will cure a patient in ICU, not when they die. Austerity measures in this country means everyone must die.
Yes.
All of us are in ICU. The war veterans, the civil servants, the members of parliament, except for the executive, which is not in ICU. So we austerity measures is about buying drugs too to get these people to survive. Obama did it in America. When he had austerity measures on him, he pumped more money into industry. And then industry started producing money. And then that money was used to revive everything. Who says austerity measures means you must punish? You need to pump money into industry so that we get more money at the end of the day. Those are also austerity measures. But we cannot have a situation where we talk about austerity measures that are not working. The TSP, Vision 2030. Does it not need to be reviewed? We had Zim Asset, 10-point plan. We now TSP. We moved quietly without review. What was the problem with Zuma said? No one ever sat down to say what the problem was. But we knew all you need is implementation. It's a good model. The cake must grow big. I was foolish in that I also decided not to get a car because I wanted to build a motor industry to do the 2018. Not that I don't want a car, but I believed in Zimmer's because it was going to now get cars manufactured here. I went to win over me the motor industry to put an order. I never got the car. I lost a car. Because I believed in Zimmer's. Then we went to the 10-point plan. What came about before the 10-point plan? Now we're in TSP and we're talking about us being on the on course for the 2030. Instead of the minister saying as a result. Thank you, Honourable Member. I indebted to you as such, I will move it again so that you will stay here. Mr. Speaker, you talk about TSP 2030. Honourable Mr. Speaker and Honourable Members of Parliament, are we on course in 2030? We're exactly there. We're exactly there. And if you're in the cycle, you die, it's an opportunity for you to say, what we budgeted for, we can no longer meet because of this accident. It was an opportune time. And because of that, we have to move back. We have a drought. And if we have a drought again, 2019-20 season, we are king. And what am I saying? Honorable Chinotimba mentioned the point that we sit on coupons and there's no fuel. Honorable Chinotimba, that's better. We want to talk about agriculture and there's no energy. So, lack of energy in 18 hours, we're talking about how much does that affect property production? The technocrats in the Ministry of Finance have done nothing to advise the minister that as a result of the power shortages, the economy comes down, not up. They can never be a surplus. The technocrats are misleading the minister. The technocrats are misleading the minister. They go to meetings noting down nothing. How can you say that the economy will grow when you've got cyclone event? When you've got a drought? When you have no power? 18 hours of no power. The miners are not mining. Gold production has gone down. Unless we are the only country which has some miracle where without electricity we are still performing. Just this weekend, if you followed, I was with some spirit mediums. No, I came to Big Norton to do some rituals there, which I respect because if I'm wrong, I do like what the Romans do.
Yeah.
They asked for the member of parliament to come. And I took a video of the future secretary, and they said, this country for as long as you don't respect us. Because you recognize the war veterans in the constitution. But who fought the war with war veterans? You talk about Uyane and the Sekuruka group. But you don't talk about us in the constitution. And they said, Timbuvara. They said, Timbuvara is in the foot. Because the constitution is the speaker said. Does not recognize the spirit meeting, but we talk about Mbianyan. I have no answer. They say to me, here is the constitution. Show us in the constitution where it talks about the spirit meeting. But if you want to struggle, we are forgetting about the role that we play. We are busy giving chiefs cash, but we are the ones who put the chiefs. So there's an issue of tradition and culture. You might laugh about it, but this is the truth. For as long as they're talking about graves of people that died that have not been exhumed and taken to where they should. And the spirits of the country are not happy. And when they're not happy, they say even this cyclone he died, who could have controlled it, but we allowed it to come so that you learn. They say you now want us to be reporting to you as government. So it's an issue, whether you believe it or not, it's up to you. But they told me that when you tell your colleagues that for as long as the spirit meetings are not respected in the country, there will be problems. Mr. Speaker said, I want to move to Command Agriculture. Command Agriculture being a noble cause that it is, I totally agree with Honorable Schlottinger that it means nothing. The amount of foreign currency that will be spent without us having an answer to the rainfall pattern, we're wasting time. The minister did not talk about how much money we spend for currency. But you, 5 minutes you told me, and then
I ask that honorable member, Temba, this is from an unlikely source, Mr. Speaker. But I ask that his time be extended.
Mr. Speaker said, what I was talking about was a situation where if we don't know the rainfall pattern, there's no point to do agriculture. We might as well just use that money to import maize until we put the right systems. Put irrigation, put cloud seeding. There was no money for cloud seeding in the budget. There was no money to pay off electricity that we owe. In summary, for as long as we don't have money for cloud seeding, let's forget about agriculture and put all the necessary framework in place. And let's also, if we don't offset the electricity money that we owe, I did not see the Minister of Energy getting any money to pay off that. So as a result, these are the fundamentals which must come first before the economy takes off. I thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, for giving this opportunity, and I'm hoping that the technocrats, wherever they are, they will listen and they will advise. Yes! Thank you.